Excellency Dr. Liu Youfa, friends, it gives me great pleasure to welcome you all here for a talk. And I'm told by the Consul General that this is the first talk he's giving after coming to Mumbai as representative of China. So we are really honored. As some of you know, the Observer Research Foundation has been very happy to have established close relationship with the consulate, the Chinese consulate in Mumbai. In the past 3 years, we've organized 11 events. This is the 12th. More than we've done with any other country in the world. Not because we believe that India's relations with other countries are less important, but because we believe that we have a lot of catching up to do as far as China is concerned. A lot of deficit is to be overcome. China is our largest neighbor, and there is now growing consensus in both countries that India and China should establish close, peaceful, and multidimensionally cooperative relations. And it's happening in some areas at least. China is our largest trading partner. The political contacts between India and China are growing in an unprecedented manner. In fact, in a few days from now, our Prime Minister and your President...
Literally tomorrow.
Yes, tomorrow. We'll be meeting in South Africa at the BRICS summit. There was a time when high-level contacts between our two countries were few and far between, but in the past 8 years, our Prime Minister has had meetings with your President, your former President, your former Prime Minister, at least together, at least a dozen times.
I think on my record, it's 14 times.
Yes. So all this really augurs well, friends, for India-China relations. At the same time, there's a need not just for the government leaders to meet, diplomats to meet, but for citizens to know about each other's developments. And it's for this reason that we requested Consul General Dr. Youfa to visit our office and deliver a talk. And the topic that we've chosen is most appropriate, most timely, China's development under its new leadership. China has a brand new leadership. It's really amazing that here is a country that after 10 years, just about everything changes. The entire top level personnel just goes to show how China has managed. China's political system has managed to ensure smooth leadership transition. The leadership of Hu Jintao and Wen Jiabao has made way for Mr. Xi Jinping and Li Keqiang. Friends, this new leadership, very impressive. It has captured the imagination of the political observers around the world in a very short time. Very confident, also quite candid about acknowledging the problems, the many problems that China is facing. For example, I was very surprised that in his very first press conference, the Prime Minister, Mr. Li Keqiang, he said that corruption and the reputation of our government, these are his words, corruption and the reputation of our government are as incompatible as fire and water. Very candid words. In many ways, the development problems of China are similar to the development problems of India, of course with significant differences. So we have a lot to learn from China, and I'm sure that China also has a lot to learn from India. Friends, I had an opportunity to visit China recently in November, December, and my impressions convinced me that China is going through some of the most interesting times. Perhaps this is the most transformative period in the history of the Chinese Communist Party. So how the new leadership faces the challenges, how it bridges the gap between people's expectations and the performance of the government will be watched very closely by people around the world. We are well wishers of China as an Asian country, as a great Asian civilization, as our neighbor with whom we've had very, very long cultural civilizational ties. We take great happiness in the successes and accomplishments of China. We wish China well, and we believe that India and China together can in many ways reshape global affairs in the 21st century. Many observers in the West believe that these two great nations of Asia, both rising, are about to have conflict. And here again, I was closely watching the pronouncements of the new leadership. Your Prime Minister says in his press conference that it is not inevitable that two great nations have to have a conflict with each other. They can establish cooperative relations and grow prosperous. This is a very wise outlook. It will certainly be welcomed by both the people as well as political leader of India. So friends, it gives me great pleasure to invite Dr. Youfa to the Observer Research Foundation. His predecessor, Mr. Niu Jingbao, was a regular visitor to our office. Our relations have actually become so close that we regard Mr. Chan almost as a member of the ORF team. Friends, I am very happy to recognize the presence today of representatives of Russia and Singapore. Shri Devdhar is here, who has very recently written a book on China. Very informative. So thank you for taking time out to come here. We also have a young journalist who is going to write a book on China, Rashmi Patel. Krishmarishma. So your talk is going to be received very attentively, and as you said, you are here to ask, you are here to answer a lot of questions, and there indeed will be a lot of questions. So I'm sure that this evening will see a very vibrant discussion on China. Thank you very much, friends. Thank you.
My dear friend, Mr. Ling, the Consul General from Singapore, and my friend Alex from the Russian Consul General. all the other respected friends. Ladies and gentlemen, Namaskar. Or Namaste. It is, of course, my great privilege to be invited to speak here to such an honorable crowd and audience. ORF is not a strange organization to me. Before I came, I was, as Mr. Kuokani told you, I was the Vice President of China Institute of International Studies, which is one of the top three think tanks to advise the Chinese leaders and the government. For that reason, I wrote quite a few policy proposals to both the new president and premier. I signed it again in my own name, not my CIIS. ORF has been my partner institution for 3.5 years while I was the president, because I was the think tank member to attach to the BRICS, the G20, the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, and the ASEAN Plus. All these functions or institutions would drive me to get closer and closer to India, because I have to do a lot of homework just to be able to advise my leaders on the respective matters. And as a result, I had the opportunity to travel twice to Delhi before I had the opportunity to be the Consul General here in Mumbai. So this is basically about my opening remarks. And the second point I want to kickstart my presentation is my colleague, Mr. Zan, and Mr. Zan just concluded a trip to Aurangabad. That was a dreamland. I began to dream when I was a child. You know, when I was standing at the cave where 1,200 years ago the Chinese Buddhist monk stood, and he described the location of those wonderful caves. And I feel so humbled and so, you know, small. I have a feeling Himalaya is a geographical barrier to separate the two countries of us, as you rightly put it, the two giant neighbors. But I had a dream. Should one venture out and stand above Himalaya, what we would see, the two nations and the two peoples with no barriers at all. So I say common people would see the Himalaya as a barrier. But we should become the ones like the Chinese Buddhist monk, who should have the courage to spend 2.5 years traveling alone to come to India, totally by himself. He received the inspirations here in India. He spent about 13 years trying to associate with the Indian scholars and counterparts. When he came, went back to China, he brought the scriptures with him, and he popularized Buddhism in China. Now it has become one of the top three religions in China. So, as the late descendant of the Buddhist culture, let me also disclose to you, I was born into a strong Buddhist family. So, it was a true soul-searching trip, and an enlightenment trip I made. I congratulate my government, my boss, to allow me to be the Consul General here. So much about my feeling. And Mr. Kuokani, you rightly mentioned that tomorrow Prime Minister Singh is going to meet with the new Chinese leader. This is the moment for us to sit back and watch and revisit the progress of our bilateral relations and to see how we're going to move forward. But before that, I'm sure many of you in the audience would have the same question. That is, how China's going to move forward after so many years of indefinite growth. Nothing can be indefinite, we all know. And many of you would then be wondering how long can it just stay there, hang in there, so to speak. But the question is not yes or no. Definitely, it's a yes. But at the same time, it's going to be more and more difficult to hang there. This is a vision as well as a challenge for China. It's a mission for China to move forward, and it's a challenge that China has to face and to tackle. So for this purpose, Mr. Kukwan, I thank you very much to pick me this very interesting topic, that is the National Development Strategy under the new leadership, as you rightly mentioned it, that, you know, China at the moment is at the crossroads. At the crossroads, indeed. As an economist by profession, I fully agree. So let me take the opportunity to share with you what I have in mind, not as a Consul General, but rather as an economist or as an academic, because that will allow me to speak from my heart. As a Consul General, I have to read. I've already discarded my paper. I'm going to talk from my heart. And I also welcome your questions. Questions with no taboos. I do not dodge. I have never dodged any questions, however sensitive or they may be. So I extend the opportunity to you to quit, to brain pick myself. Now, Mr. Kukwani, I agree with you that I'll usually, when I give the speeches, I talk about 10 minutes, I'll throw the floor open for questions. At one extreme case, I had about 60 some questions. So, I don't suppose I would challenge you to break this record. But anyway, I promised Mr. Kukwani that I'll talk about the topic for about 50 minutes, then I'll leave the, whatever the time remaining for Q&A. Would that be okay with you? Okay. Can you hear me?
Very well.
As a professor, I used to rattle along like a machine gun, so I purposefully encode my tempo. So shout out when I speak too fast to you. Well, the topic I chose is China's national development strategy under the new leadership. I basically had a draft outline here about the new leadership. I'll let you see some of their photos, but I'll dwell myself on China's development strategies and the challenges that China is faced with. As for the way forward for China, probably I do not have the time. This is a kind of presentation which was meant for 70 minutes, but I only have about 50 minutes. So let me just walk you through into my outline, with your permission, about the new leadership. We see this was a picture taken a couple of months ago at the end of the Party Congress. So this is the new leadership who is traveling to Durban. He's flying at the moment in a special airline to Durban and in South Africa. And this is a photo of the young premier. He's 1 year younger than I am. See how energetic he is. This is the chairman of the National People's Congress, the legislative branch. And this is Mr. Yuzhen of the National Political Consultative Conference of China. These are the four core leaders at the core. We have seven in total. We call it, the G7 here. G7. Well, no time for the stories about the new leaders. Let me just basically mention these. What I prepared, probably in a minute you could question me on these regards. But because of the time limit, I'll have to skip it. Because with every topic, I could write a chapter. This is exactly one book I'm about to complete. So China's strategies against the background of economic globalization, how China should do political strategy, China would have to join the mainstream political system, but how China is going to do it, that's a challenge. And the economic strategy, that is, we call ourselves socialist market economy, but how does China sell the concept to the world? That's another challenge. Well, culturally, we call, China used to be a very closed society, very, Maoist, as you might call it. But now China has joined the mainstream international community, but how China is to associate itself with the international community culturally? Science strategy, China is the second biggest economy, but in terms of the strength, you wouldn't believe it. Last year, it stood at 87th place. That was the real China. When you talk about the figures about China, it's great. When you talk about the comprehensive strength, that's another story. So, anything has two sides, so is China. Defense strategy. I'm sure many of my Indian friends would have this in mind when China's become stronger. Could it all fly over Himalaya and take over India? That's a question. It's so natural. I do not blame anybody for thinking so. But does China have any reason to do so? Let me give you an answer right at the moment. Suppose the question, China has had so many people to look after. China has 140 some million people who are living under poverty. Does China have a couple of more million people who would have to depend on the government? Fool would do that, right? Defense strategy, security strategy, and the global strategy that relates closely to the global governance. Well, as I promised, I just want to walk you through very briefly through my outline. I leave these strategies for platforms where you can formulate your questions. I should appreciate it if you could help me to realize that goal. But I do want to share with you where China is, and especially where China is going, in order for you to more easily to see China. 40 years down the road, China has three great dreams. The first one is peaceful national reunification. China, as the third largest country in terms of land and the largest country in the world, but China is still pending for national reunification. China is the only major power around the world who are still plagued with the feeling of national reunification. Certainly, this is a dream for China. And secondly, it's the completion of the construction of a well-to-do society by the year 2021. The second dream, translated simply, means by the year, that is seven years down the road, China will have to complete the goal to let people live a well-to-do life. I do purposely skip the word rich life because China will never be that level with so many people. A well-to-do society means everybody should be entitled to adequate education, living, housing, and transportation, the right to participate in the national politics, and to the rights to air their feelings against or for the government. Well to do. And the third great grand dream for China is to graduate from the developing country by the year 2049. That year will coincide with the founding of the People's Republic. So I used to, the former president used to give me and my colleagues, one assignment. He said, give us the projection by 2049, what China will look like. What are the challenges I will have, my future, the colleagues will face? We did the projection. So these are the three dreams for China. if you understand China, why China would have to stick to the peaceful, the road of peaceful development, the simple reason because all these 3 reasons would not allow China to do anything else. Concentration on the domestic development, concentration on the social harmony, and concentration for the realization of the national reunification peacefully. Now, these are the second point I want to draw your attention to is the political reforms. And many of my friends might think that China always a communist country. The CPC would never allow any party to do anything else. It's one party rule, right? I don't blame you for thinking that way. As an outside, so natural. But the political reform, as I look at it, this is probably an academia roadmap for China in terms of political reforms. The first one, the near-term goal, is reform of the administrative system. That's in line with the 12's 5-year guideline, the new party platform, which is coinciding with your 5-year economic plan. You started this year, China started last year. So the economic cycle, or the political cycles between India and China are very much alike. You know, we could ride the same curve, one after the other. And the big midterm goal, as I look at it, is a dynamic multi-party cooperation and political consultation under the leadership of the CPC. Multi-party cooperation, it's not a rubber stamp. We have many, leaders from other political parties who have become the vice, the premier, ministers and vice ministers, governors, and also we have, at the political consultative conference, nationally, we have one, leader from one minority nationalities. And the second was the political consultation. And political consultative conference is a mechanism within which all the visions and the critics and all the strategic thoughts for national development will be channeled and put forward for the national leaders to seek references from. So the midterm goal is to establish a dynamic multi-party cooperation and political consultation system under the leadership of the CPC. And the CPC here will also undergo reforms. Reforms will happen within the CPC in these areas, and the stable and sustainable change of the leadership. We have abandoned the leaders who stay in power as long as they would wish, like mom, until we die, right? No, it's a thing of the past. 10 years, no matter how bright you are, how much energetic you are, you go. Like, President Bush and Calvin, Premier Winchell, they give their post happen. This is the system. And the second is the accountability of all the cabinet ministers. Whoever fails at the test by the National People's Congress for consecutive years, he or she will be removed at the post immediately. So the orderly transfer of power, the transparency of the policies, and the connections between the government and the people, as you rightly put it, it's some kind of like water and fire relations. We have to tackle that issue here. And this one, the second one is, economically speaking, is to elevate the status of China at the international chains, the production chains and goods and service chains, the capital chains and the technology chains, and especially the information chains. These are you think China is the second biggest economy. When you look, puts China into all these 5 chains, China remains at the lower level of the international global chain. Like India, we are both very low, according to my studies. So we both have to work hard to elevate the statuses at the international level. And the third one is to reform is to the ultimate goal is to build a socialism with the Chinese characteristics. The socialist China tomorrow by the year 2049 will definitely not the one enchanted by Karl Marx. 200 years ago, it will never be that, you know, idealistic. And it's going to be real Chinese socialism. This is a difficult terminology for you to understand. I decided to put it aside. But these are the political reforms. Just want to give you a sketch that China, how China is going to go through. And the key political issues at stake, I just want to draw your attention here. You know, the political issues at stake, are the in these areas, the first one is more policy transparency. The closed-door decision-making mechanism has become a thing of the past. The CPC would have to change its way in order to win the massive support of the people at the rank and file level. And the second one is more national governance. Let me tell you, beforehand, a couple of years ago, some officials would ruin their portfolios, and they would be promoted and to another place, and they continue to make the same mistakes, bigger mistakes. But this is a thing of the past. The accountability will be strictly observed. You have to undergo the scrutiny of the special agencies before you are allowed to go, because otherwise, when you decide to be corrupted, you go behind the bar. This is the future system for China. So more national governance and more public and social scrutiny. The scrutiny oversight by the civil societies, by the media, and by the academic circles. This is a new area. The number four is more accountability of the politicians. We have seen, traditionally, ministers will be above the laws. For quite some time it was so. This has done away with. The accountability of the politicians, before they leave the office, they will have to undergo the strict scrutiny, the disciplinary inspections to make sure that when they were at the office, they would have to abide by the moral, disciplinary, and legal codes. Accountability. And the more accountability for the public servants. Okay, I'm a diplomat. Theoretically, I am a public servant. I have to disclose my accounts, my investment, whatever I have. If I hide anything at the end of my tenure of office, I will be in trouble. So this is the kind of accountability. They have to be loyal to the country, to the system, and to their portfolios. Take me for example. So these are the political issues which would help to make Chinese politics more clean, more cleaner in the future. So these are the things I advise you should watch China for those of my friends who are interested in China politics. And you don't have to take notes, I'll leave my PPT. So that's no, I'm glad you're probably right, so okay. As of a good one, I'll leave it with you. You can copy it so you can just walk alongside with me throughout my outline. The economic issues, just for your reference, these are the things I think I've advised my leaders when I was back in Beijing. And the first one is the further overhaul on gross modality. Chinese economy depends too much on exports. The dependency rate has come above 42, which is a critical red line zone, as I would call it. China would have to reverse its modality, gross modality. So the exports-led economic gross modality is no longer workable in China. And further fine-tune on economic structure, China is still depending too much on heavy industries. It used to be very much workable alongside with the national situation, it's no longer. China needs a lot more in some areas. And the fine-tune of the economic structure. And the other structure is the agriculture and the in relation to the industries. This is also the structure. The structure of the urban economy and the rural economy. And the third one is the cultivate domestic consumption. You wouldn't believe it. Chinese people love sailing. They're crazy. The deposit rate is on saving rate is as much as 44% of what they earn. This is the problem. You know, in the commercial life, excessive saving is the worst enemy alongside with inflation to the governments at all levels. Chinese government is faced with this critical scenario here. So domestic consumption will have to be something to work at. And the fourth one is urbanization and culture construction. Let me share with you, my dear friends, you may wonder how long China is going to hang there. It is going to hang there for quite a long time to come. The basic reason is urbanization and town share. For 1% increase of urban population, it will create a tangible consumption population of 14 million people. So this is, right at the moment, the urban population is only 52% by the developed countries' standards. We have about 20% more to go. So we have 20 years at least to go. We just have to increase 1% of the urban population 1 year. And 20 years down the road, China will be safe. That's a simple equation there. Now, the increase of the disposable income of the people. Would Chinese government has decided resolutely to increase the disposable income, but Chinese government will find an uphill battle to let people know to consume will be enough benefit their own families, but also for their own future. So this is the kind of behavioral change of the Chinese people is a daunting task here. Number six, the government promotes agro-modernization. The Chinese government is still faced with a daunting task to reduce the rural population, which stands at 48%. But how? This is a problem. I am sure that India has a lot more challenges than China does at the moment. But still, that is why the national situations of China and India are very much identical in quite a few areas. Number six is to further promote, number seven is to harmonize distribution of social wealth. This is a critical issue for China to tackle. The uneven distribution. We have billionaires, and as I said a minute ago, we still have 140 some million people who are still living with less than $1.2 US per day. And that's much more, according to my estimation. This is the truth I'm telling you. And the wealth to be spent among the urban areas and the rural areas still unbalanced equation here. And number eight is to consolidate social safety net systems. And China still has to pull the short board a little bit longer. Because when people feel unsafe in the future, they refuse to consume today. They will save up for the future. Excessive saving is the worst enemy for the government. So this is kind of a difficult scenario to handle. Okay, now, the foreign policy side, I think I also listed four areas here. The global governance via multilateral diplomacy. China will never be able to manage its national construction or development by going alone. China used to close its door to the outside world and had its lessons. So the global governance and India and China here are again in the same boat. That is, because both India and China are the latecomers in terms of industrialization and the international trade, international investment, you name it. We have to obey the rules like it or not. So this is the scenario we have to get across. And the second one is to further consolidate relations with the key countries, including India. China regards India as the emerging countries. We have the kind of equations. China does lays importance to the key countries, including the developed countries and the emerging countries. Here India falls into this category. And I'll tackle questions if you have any in that regard. And the number three is the harmonious neighborhood
reasons are simple. China has imported FDI, the technologies from the developed world. China absorbs those technologies and invents, you know, some added minor inventions. Now these technologies are ready not to go upward. Water will never flow up to the hills. It's only natural for them to flow downward to the destination countries. Technology, production chains, and goods and services, capital, and information, you name it. So this is why China in foreign policy would have to regard the developing countries at the basis. Without this leg, China is going to fall. China is not going to end there any longer. Now, Mr. Kulkarni, you mentioned China had quite, you know, two or three challenges, but as an economist, I want to tell you, these are the major challenges that China is faced with. And just to start with, supplies of the factors of production. And you wouldn't believe it. After 25 years of almost double digits annual economic growth, China is at a critical stage whereby China would have to work a lot harder just to get enough factors of production from the international market. Oil, gas, and all the major metals. Just to name a few. And sustainable economic growth. I simply sometimes have to convince myself how China is going to maintain that seemingly undropping, unfalling economic growth trend. But this is a difficult thing. But it's not an mission impossible. I've given you enough reasons why I said so. The economic balances between the urban and rural economies, between the external and internal economic activities, between the some in the, we call it the rising industries and the sunset industries, the way in terms of wage and salaries and the perks and the social benefits and entitlements. These are the areas where China would have to, you know, regard them as challenges. And the positions in international chains, I've explained, in terms of capital, goods and service, technology, information, as well as human capital. You think China has 1.3 population, people. It's a huge labor market, labor force, right? It's not. In this regard, India has more educated, capable labor force than China does. You would say I'm crazy. I'm not crazy. As a economist, I talk by facts. Because as I estimated, India has a population of some 600 million who are fluent in English. But with the population, you know, divided by the people who are fluent in English, China has about 16 million only. So China's a junior brother as compared to India. Remember this. That's something true. China will have to do a lot more in order to elevate itself at the international chains. This is, you know, the one benchmark is the language, the working language. And that's it, social harmony. As you might read from the news reporting, we do have social discontent. You know, they have the unrest, they have the, we call it, visits to the provincial capital cities to get their grievances addressed. You know, we call it, you know, people who are going to the capital to get their grievances addressed. Harmony, social harmony is something for China to tackle now, because China has accumulated enough capital, wealth, and the experience to address this critical issue, inflation. I think India and China are in the same boat. After, I'm being frank, please forgive me for the frankness. Inflation is the twin, you know, the two, for economists, two worst enemies. One is, right? One of the two is inflation. China reports from the four, that will probably be more objective. Because that's the proper the publicity to make the new government looks good, make the new leaders look good, right? So, but it's not, I can tell you for sure. 4% of the inflation, I'll never believe it. That's the economist. I'll never buy the story. But inflation is a problem. It's still manageable because when you think that China has been growing at double digits for 25 years, that 14% of real inflation was manageable. It was something pretty good, quote unquote. Demographic pressures. I think that India and China again is in the same boat. We have many more young people coming to the labor market. And last year in China, 17% of young people went into the labor market. 17 million across China. I don't know how many from India, but in more or less around 9 or so millions from India. So, and also we have the second. India does not have the second scenario, that is the great population. The people who are above and over 16 years old. The social security, the pension system, simply these two will be the killing pressures on the government. China is reaching the yellow light zone now if it becomes developed country. 13% gray population. The red line is 20. We're getting hitting the red line zone now. Corruption. I hate it. They should put the corruption. I don't like it. But this is the kind of, I call it structural phenomenon or scenario. No country is free of corruption. But this has to be brought within the framework of constitution and the policies and the regulations or ethic code. China will manage. This has become one of the top three issues for China, for the Chinese new leaders. So corruption is an issue to look after. Well, I'm coming to the end of my presentation here. Just for your references, I put nicely further, six further, I call it. If my new leaders would do these as I advise them, they should be had to make sure that China is going to end it before they are voted out. So further political economic reforms. China cannot survive without the deepening reform, both in political and economic area, and opening up policy. That's the second of the further emancipate productivity. I wonder if you agree with me here. GDP is something like a moon cake in the sky. It looks nice, but there isn't much to enjoy because GDP is different. What is more important to the people is the money, the pocket, right? Disposable income, not even the per capita GDP. It's the disposable income that's more important to the people when they decide. So the disposable income will be pretty much decided by the productivity. Economic scale would not solve this issue. Productivity will get there. The third one is to further improve competitiveness. No country, or no companies or enterprises would be compatible at the international level can say, oh, it's a large, a strong company or a strong enterprise. So international competitiveness is the way, one benchmark to decide if a country is competitive or a strong country. And number four is to further improve people's livelihood. The Chinese government, the new leaders would have to make sure that people would increase their disposable income against the index of inflation. That's more important. And number five is to further promote social harmony. This is, social harmony is an issue. So it's the major top five issues for the Chinese government, the new leaders. Last but not least, international cooperation. Like India, we are the brothers. Are the one oriental culture, Chinese culture, took a lot of enlightenment from the Indian culture. So international cooperation, both at the economic, political, and cultural levels, would make India and China stronger and more prosperous. And that is, we call it, the, and that is why our two governments, the leaders of our two countries, have decided that the two countries should form and implement the strategy of strategic relations of peace, prosperity, and coordination. So, we're just seeing. Having said so much, I want to conclude my presentation here. Basically, I've walked you through the kind of the new leadership that you might think, the strategies they have for themselves, the challenges they have faced with, and my personal roadmap for the future. Just for your references. Remember, whatever said is my personal understanding that I came as an academic. So you can use what I said, but do not quote Dr. Liu Youfa. You have to save me. I have 2 years to retire.
Thank you.
Now I'm ready for questions.